So here's our timeline again of the topics we want to cover. And as I had done previously, I've struck through those topics that I've already talked in the previous video. So now what we're coming up to in 1946 is the ENIAC computer at the University of Pennsylvania. And this is, as you'll see in the next slide, the first computer. And this particular part of the series, we're going to discuss the evolution of the computer as it leads into the microcomputer. So I'm going to close this one. So in this section, I want to start with just giving a little bit of history about computers, which at this point in time include the mainframe types. What is a computer? It's a calculator and then some. And as such, a computer must perform calculator type operations such as add, subtract, multiply, and divide. And indeed, all of them do. But in addition, a computer can also perform your Boolean logic operations that we've shown previously, such as and or, in a bitwise fashion, including maybe 8 bits, or even in today's computers, 64 bits at a time doing those type of operations. In addition, computer has the capability to alter what it's doing depending on the results of a logical decision. And then I put here, for example, is A greater than B? If the answer is yes, then let's stop. That's one typical and very simple example. So a computer is a device that operates using a set of instructions provided by a user, and this is known as the program. Various programming languages have been developed to simplify the process of getting the data into the computer. And ultimately, the data that goes into the computer is loaded as binary data bits, ones and zeros. So it takes a whole lot of them to hold the contents of a very, very large program. And this is why we have what are known as computer languages. So here from my alma mater, University of Pennsylvania, and this even predates me, I'm a pretty old guy, but back in 1946 came the ENIAC. And the ENIAC is generally attributed to be the first operational computer. And this ENIAC can be seen still, parts of it, at the Moore School of Engineering. In the lower right is basically the history of it. In the lower left is a picture of one of the vacuum tube modules that this computer had. This particular device had the data input by the various switches you see directly in the foreground. So it took a lot of work to get the data in. And in reality, this was developed for the military in order to calculate the trajectory of a ballistic shell. This kind of predated missiles, but that's what it was used for, was to calculate arsenal trajectories. Whole lot of work just for that, but that's what it was. So here is in an early computer a cluster of vacuum tubes that you might typically see. In addition to the tubes, there are hundreds of accompanying resistors and a smaller number of capacitors, but nonetheless it's pretty complex and physically large. Some of the takeaways from this type of computer included obviously the physical size, the power consumption, tubes produced heat, the lifetime of the tubes. They did burn out after you boiled all the electrons off the cathode. There were no more. You had to replace your tube. In addition, tubes used hazardous voltages, often into the hundreds. But despite this, vacuum tubes are still in wide use today, particularly in the broadcast industry with transmitter outputs for TV and radio stations, and are also highly sought after in high-end audio equipment because they're extremely low in self-generated noise. So let's move forward in our quest to further look at the computer. One of the things you want to have with a computer is a means of storing your data. So here, as you can see next to a fairly large airplane being unloaded, or maybe loaded, is an early computer hard drive. This is from the 1950s. And as you can see from the fine print, it's about the size of two refrigerators. And at that time, it would cost $400,000 in today's dollars. So pretty expensive, pretty large. And obviously to say we've come a long way with these is an understatement, because today in your laptop, where literally each passenger can have one in an airplane, you have a drive which is substantially more powerful than this one and is yet extremely portable. One point in time that I consider groundbreaking in the history of the computer is the introduction of the IBM 360. And this is what we all remember when we see computer rooms and lots of equipment. It's nice and clean and brightly lit, all kinds of lights blinking. The IBM Model 360 was first introduced in 1964. It had a range of many different model numbers, all depending on performance and how much you were willing to pay. A typical one might be the Model 50, and it could operate 2 million 32-bit instructions per second, and as such it could perform 307,000 additions per second. It contained a magnetic core for holding data that was wanting to be used in rapidity, comparable to today's RAM memory, and 8 megs of core. And the core itself had 8 microseconds of access time, meaning it took 8 millionths of a second to put new data into it or to find and retrieve data. Note the tape backup reels in the room. Every time you had a day's worth of data, you backed it up. These particular machines were programmed in either Fortran, if you had a scientific operation to do, or COBOL for business applications. As we'll see today, there are other languages available, but that's typically what you used in your IBM 360. Again, this is a groundbreaking machine of the early days, and these hung around until very late in the 70s. So now looking at our timeline, we've erased a lot of the items. And we're up to around the 1970s, where it says the Intel 4004. And this is basically the last part of our adventure through computer benchmarks. And so when we reach the UNO, there'll be another live video to show you the UNO in action. And that'll be the end of our story. So thanks for viewing in advance, but there is more. So let me stop this one and continue to. Semiconductor technology really went crazy through the 1960s, and by 1971, and I guess I misspoke just previously, but November 15th of 1971, the Intel 4004, again, truly a benchmark device. This is the first microprocessor, and some of the specifications are outlined here. The clock speed was only 100,000 per second. The chip had 2,300 transistors, as you can see in the photograph lower right. It only ran like 60,000 instructions per second. And you can see the line size of the circuit called 10 micron. Today, feature sizes are down in what's called nanometers, or billionths of a micron. So chip size, feature size has come a long way. The chip could address 640 bytes of memory, and it was originally built on a 2-inch wafer. Actually, this chip wasn't meant to be used as a standalone microprocessor, but instead it powered what was called the Busicon calculator and paved the way for future microprocessors to come into the mainstream. Again, This is truly a benchmark in the universe of transistorized circuits and computers. So now our Intel 4004 has grown up, and in 1974, this is the 1974 benchmark, the 8080. And this computer, microcomputer, ran 8 bits of data at a time versus the 4004 only processed 4 bits of data. So it really wasn't very powerful in terms of the numbers. And here now we have a computer that can handle 8 bits of data, and it had ways of combining those into 16 bits at a time so it could do some of the operations even a little faster. So again, looking at the benchmarks, and this device was 30 years in life, discontinued 30 years ago and marketed and designed by Intel. The clock rate here could be as much as 3.25 million per second, so it was much, much faster. Contained 6,000 transistors. The feature size had dropped to 6 microns, and it had a brand new instruction set, which was really quite powerful in its day. So here's a picture of the chip on the left-hand side of the screen, and this is in a ceramic case and gold-plated pins, pretty fancy looking. Now it should be noted that this computer was basically the father of many other well-known computers that followed, including the Intel 8085 and the Zilog Z80, which was used in the TRS-80, and that the native instructions, the assembly language, were also used in those follow-up computers. So it was really a benchmark in many, many ways, including its streamlined and much more efficient assembly language. So now fast forward into about 1995. And the debut of the Atmel Mega 328. It's part of the Mega series of chips. And this is the chip that's used in the Arduino Uno. And here to start, I found a couple pictorials that I put together that allow you to basically see the proportions of these chips. So if you look along the left-hand side, you can see that the entire device, this is a surface-mounted version, is only 1/4 inch by 1/4 inch, and the leads are spaced 31/1000ths of an inch apart. So what you see is this is blown up quite a bit to put it on the screen. The entire chip will fit on the tip of your little finger, the fingernail size. So it's pretty tiny. Where did we come to? Well, this chip can run up to 16 million instructions a second, and these are 8-bit instructions. It can go to sleep, which is something you really had a hard time to do with the 8080, and while sleeping, it can take as little as 1/1 millionth of an amp, so it'll last a long, long time, even sleeping on a battery. You wake it up by just taking a single pin to a logic zero state. And this particular chip contains roughly 1 million transistors. And you can see the chip sitting inside the package. So it's pretty impressive. You can see where things have come to in basically just 20 years. And again, remember, this is the engine for our Arduino Uno. So just for informational purposes, here's a bigger photograph of the die that's in the Atmel Mega chip, and you can see some of the different features. The piece that looks like a football field is really part of the memory of the device, and some other obviously unique features along the left hand side, although I'm not sure what those are. But again, picture a million transistors, and you've seen some transistors already, what one looks like. Picture putting a million of them in here in this tiny little chip. Again, quite impressive. So now we've arrived at our destination, the Uno. And here, courtesy of Arduino, in a public domain picture, is a picture of the latest version of the Uno Type R3. And There was an arrow pointing to the 328, the Mega 328 chip. You can see how tiny it is on the board. But an Uno itself is a little bit less than 3 inches long and not quite as wide. But you can see it's a pretty compact little thing, maybe the size of a pack of cigarettes. And some of the features, you can see a USB plug at the far left, and just beneath that little black plug, if you don't want to power it from USB, you can put somewhere between 7 and 20 volts on that pin, as indicated in the data on the right. The Uno has 14 input-output pins, and 6 of those can provide what's known as PWM, which is pulse width modulation. You can filter pulse width modulation so it looks like an analog signal. It also has a UART, meaning it can receive data and talk to an external smart device like a terminal or a computer. It talks a language called I2C, which is basically a serial communication similar to USB. You can send a lot of data over just a few simple wires. It contains 6 analog input pins, analog to digital converters, so it can actually go and measure down to a couple thousandths of a volt with an accuracy of 1 part in 1024. Each pin can put out 20 milliamps. It also has an auxiliary power supply that can produce some 3.3 volt power for some peripherals. Memory size, it has 32,000 bytes of memory. A little bit of it's used to load the software. It has 2,000 bytes of RAM. RAM is temporary scratchpad memory, which is very fast. It also has 1,000 bytes of EEPROM. EEPROM is permanent memory. In other words, if you program into EEPROM and turn the device off, that memory stays in the EEPROM, comes back when you can turn it on, and you can rewrite it. You can also rewrite the flash memory, as you'll see soon, but not as conveniently as EEPROM, which you can work from your program. This little guy can run 16 million clock speed clocks per second, and again, you can see the dimensions and the weight. So here it is, great little computer board, and last but not least, we need to program it. So we talked about programming languages and how we use them in the IBM 360. Your Arduino uses a programming language known as C, or a newer version of it, C++. And Arduino, part of what they did is they developed a system which makes it very easy to write and program your device. And it's called an IDE, Integrated Development Environment. Here is a screenshot from my IDE, and I wrote a little program. Well, actually, I borrowed some of it from David Mellis' program from back in 2006, but I did embellish it. And this was built to demonstrate debouncing of a switch input. But in addition, I put in a little, some announcements to be used on the serial port, and you'll see those happen a little bit later. So the first thing you do when you want to program one of these, you can type all this in. Everything you see here was either hand typed or copied and pasted, but you can easily reverse case, reverse direction, and retype. You need to define what your input and output pins are going to do, and you can define a word called high to define the state of a pin. And you also have something known as an integer, which is can be a number between 0 and 32,767. So we have integers of previous. We have integers of reading. We also have what's called a long variable. This program uses some data called millis, which is the number of milliseconds since the device has been turned on. And it can quickly exceed number 32767. So it uses a long integer which can be up to 4 billion. It takes a while to fill a long integer. So we use a long integer in time and another one called debounce. Next thing you have to do with one of these is you have to do a setup. And this part of your program just runs one time. You set up your serial port, and after it's set up at 9600 baud, I say, hello world, let's begin. You have to define how your two pins are going to work. And I define the input pin as having an input pull-up, uses a built-in 20,000 ohm resistor. For the output pin, we called it out pin, and I said it's going to be an output. And each portion of this program, when you write in C, is enclosed with curly braces. That's part of what you have to do. And each statement ends with a semicolon. You can see that. And the compiler is very, very picky about how these statements are written. If they're not correct, it'll tell you in kind of a cryptic message. So this was the first part of the program. Let's move to the second part. So my note to the right-hand side of this says, to the left is the main repeating code. This part of the program is called loop. And this part of the program runs between the curly braces over and over and over again and until you would tell it to stop. So what's actually happening here is it's reading the state of pin number 2, and it's checking it for a period of 2/10 of a second to see if it's only been pressed once in that interval. And if it has been, it changes the state to the opposite state. It's pretty cool. And you'll see this happen when it actually works. Then the other thing is, obviously, after you test it, you write to the output pin. And then what I decided to do is every second, there's a 1 second delay at the bottom for this to repeat, I printed the state of the output pin. And it'll print on what you'll see as a monitor screen, and you can have this as part of your IDE. And at the very end, a curly brace to end the loop portion of the program. So this is what you use to program your Arduino. And this is a typical piece of code. If you feel like copying it and trying it in your Arduino and getting the program is freeware. So feel free to do whatever you want to do with it. It's available in the public domain. And that's another part of it that's really cool. So let's go on to the last portion of this where we actually put all this into action. I have the Arduino IDE running on my computer. This is the program that will allow you to debug your code and actually load your Arduino device itself. And on the right-hand side, I actually have an Arduino that right now has been programmed, and it's hooked to the USB port, which is normally how you do this. But let me just go through the steps that you would if you were going to write your own program and execute it. First thing you do is, if you see my mouse in the upper left checkbox, I'd run that, and this is what's called a compile. It's going to check the accuracy of the code, make sure that the punctuations and braces are all in the correct place. And if it says it's successful, there's a message on the bottom. And the next thing you do is there's an arrow called upload. Upload will take that code and send it as binary information so that the Arduino itself can understand it. And right now it's doing that. And when it's done, it will say done uploading down in the lower left, down here where I just put my pointer. I've written some serial communication with this program. So if I go up to the top where it says tools and I say serial monitor and I bring it on, I have a message that says, hello world, let's begin. And it tells me the logical state of the LED, the bright LED, not the one that's flashing that you can see in your screen. And if I hold my red wire over a ground point for more than 2/10 of a second, it now says my output state is 0. Hold it again for 2/10 of a second. Light turns back on, output state is 1. One more time on this. Hold it 2/10 of a second. LED goes out, output state 0. And once more, output state 1, LED on. So this is a demo of what you can do basically with the tools that Arduino gives you and the Arduino itself. The possibilities are pretty much limitless. I hope the video has been both entertaining and educational. Thanks for looking. Have a great day and stay safe.